be always abounding in the work of our Lord. Why? Because we know that the labors of this world, and there are many labors that accompany being in this world, but the labors that are in this world will not be in vain. Greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's my privilege to be able to come to you today and bring you this devotion. My name is Brian Myers. I'm the academic advisor at the Fairbanks campus of Wayland Baptist University, and we are the furthest north campus in the Wayland system. And we are up here serving the same God and with the same mission as many of you in other parts and places within the United States. There is a Chinese proverb that says, "May you live in interesting times." Now, is that a blessing or a curse? In many ways, and for many of us, it might seem like a blessing, because who wants to live in uninteresting times? But in reality, it is a curse, because to live in interesting times, or at least it was considered a curse, because to live in interesting times meant times of turmoil and times of difficulty. We live as servants of a living God. And whether we live in interesting times or uninteresting times, we are placed where we are by the hand of a sovereign God who is good and kind and gives us a position and a place fitting for our need of the time and fitting and appropriate for His goal in our lives, and that being our sanctification or our looking more like Christ. Now, how we handle interesting times or uninteresting times, I think, is directly related to the direction of our focus. Where are you going to focus during the times in which you live? I am absolutely convinced that it is always right, regardless of the times in which we live, that it is always right to focus our eyes upon the hope that we have in Jesus Christ of the resurrection. Now, in order to do that, I want to read for us from 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and picking up in verse 50. "I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trump will sound. For the trump will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast and immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." And that is a good word for us at all times. It is a word about the hope of the resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15 has been called the resurrection chapter, and that is an appropriate name for that particular chapter because the focus is upon the resurrection. And in this chapter, Paul breaks down for us and lays out a number of things about the resurrection. And the basic issue that was going on within the Corinthian church seems to be that there were people who were denying the fact and the reality of the resurrection. And what Paul was saying is, if there is no resurrection from the dead, then you're still in your sins. Christ has not been raised. We've misrepresented God. Any hope that we might have is based upon a completely false premise. And then ultimately, we above all people are most to be pitied. Why are we most to be pitied? because we have lived our lives based upon a hope of the promise of the resurrection, and it wouldn't be true. Of course, we know that the resurrection is a reality. We know that Christ has been raised from the dead. Therefore, our hope is real, and that we, above all people, should be characterized by the greatest of joy and satisfaction in knowing of what God is doing. That's the earlier part of 1 Corinthians, and Paul moves on to answer some questions about the resurrection. What is this resurrection body like? How does all of these things happen? And in this last part of 1 Corinthians 15, Paul explains how it is that these perishable bodies that we have put on the imperishable, and how these mortal bodies that we have put on immortality. And oh, what a glorious promise that is. And it is the hope of the resurrection that these perishable bodies shall put on imperishable, and these mortal bodies shall put on immortality. This is a great hope that we have. Well, how does it take place? Paul says it's a mystery in verse 51. I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In the moment, in a twinkling of an eye, the last trump will sound. For the trump will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. How is it that we put on imperishable bodies? Paul says, it's a mystery. He can't explain it to us. We can't understand it, even if he couldn't understand it, even if he could explain it to us. The reality of these perishable mortal bodies putting on immortality and hope is a great mystery. And while it's a mystery, the fact of it being a mystery takes nothing away from the reality that it's true. And that's what Paul says. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the trump will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Just like that, in the moment of the twinkling of an eye, that trump will sound, and everyone who is found in Christ shall instantaneously and mysteriously, but gloriously, be changed because of Christ. And he says that when the perishable, in verse 54, when the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where's your victory? O death, where's your sting? I'd like you to note the timetable of that. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and when the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. We still live in a world that is characterized by death. Indeed, we look around us and we see many of the effects of man's fall into sin and living in, for many, in a state of alienation from God. The chief one being death. The reality is that each of us will die, whether we be in Christ or not. We all die. But Paul tells us that there will come a time, the trumpet will sound, the mortal bodies will put on immortality, the perishable will put on the imperishable, and then the sting of death will be moved, and we will be able to join together. We who are in Christ will be able to join together with all the saints and say, O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? That is a great day. That is a great promise that comes to us, not based upon some fantasy that we have, but based upon the reality of the promise that God has made, and based upon the hope of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. At this point, I should probably pause and point out the qualification that I've made on a couple of occasions. I said that we who are in Christ shall put on the imperishable, and the mortal body shall put on immortality. And the reality is that for those who are in Christ, for those who have saving faith in Jesus Christ, who are trusting in Him, who believe in the reality of the gospel and have been reconciled to God, who believe that Christ died on the cross for their sins in their place, such that all who believe in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. Let me urge you at this point that if you have not put your faith in him, that to make that your top priority, to search the scriptures, to find believers around you and ask them, what does it mean to become a Christian? How is it that I become a Christian? And to search those things out, to ask God to give you a heart to change such that you may trust in him. Because when you trust in him, and for all who trust in him, we have that glorious hope that this imperishable body shall put on, or this perishable body shall put on the imperishable. Well, in verse 57, Paul writes, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And that victory that God gives is indeed a comprehensive victory. It is a victory over death, our greatest enemy, and a victory over all the other realities that we know as a result of living in a world of sin. God will give us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 58, we have, in this passage so far, we have all of these high-level theologies. The reality of the resurrection has been set forth, and Paul concludes it in the most practical of terms. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is vain. And it is that word that I want to leave you with as a word of encouragement to you. Beloved brothers, as a result of the hope that you have in God, be steadfast and immovable. In fact, keep yourself about the work of our God. Be always abounding in the work of our Lord. Why? Because we know that the labors of this world, and there are many labors that accompany being in this world, but the labors that are in this world will not be in vain. As we apply ourselves to the Lord's work, as we pour ourselves out, as we give ourselves in this context to the task of education and are about the mission of Wayland Baptist University, as it is in the Lord, that work is not in vain. So brothers and sisters, be steadfast. Be immovable. Focus your eyes upon God. Be reminded that your labor is not in vain.